All right, now we're going to be picking up where we left off this morning. Of course, this morning's sermon, we started getting into the subject of repentance and salvation and what it takes for a person to be saved. Is repentance a part of that? We dealt, just to give a brief recap of what we've already gone over this morning. We were looking at the definition of repent, which just basically means to change or to turn or to, you know, to basically change your mind or to think. And when you're repenting, you're basically just changing your mind on what you thought before to be something different. Now, that can oftentimes be associated with grief, with sorrow, with sadness, or with following up with an action. But you have to get the context of how the word is used in order to give its true meaning within the parameters of the sentence. So what we're doing now is going through, I brought up some references this morning from the Old Testament, just a few, to help us get a good idea of repent and what the word means and seeing it in different contexts. Some where there's a lot of grief, some where God is doing the repenting, some where it has zero grief at all, you know, just to help us get a full understanding of the word repent. And now what we're doing is we're going through every single time the word repent in one form or another is used in the New Testament. Because what we're doing is we're judging this false gospel of you have to turn from your sins to be saved, specifically, because people will, when they preach, a lot of people, when they preach repentance, that you need to repent in order to be saved, they're not referring to putting your faith on Christ. But rather, what they're referring to is turning your back on a life of sin. Turning around from sin, doing a 180, if you will, maybe turning over a new leaf in your life and wanting to do what's right. But that is not salvation. We've been going through all the verses. We made it all the way through the Gospels. And, I mean, if you're not going to find it in the Gospels where Jesus Christ was preaching, then, you know, it's going to be hard-pressed to find anywhere else. But we didn't see it in the Gospels, so we're going to continue on here from Acts and go forward and look at every single reference to the word repent. So we started off in Acts 8. We're gonna start here since this is what we read. We read the entire chapter, and I've seen people try to use Acts 8 to justify that you have to turn from your sins. Now, just to recap this story, the part of Scripture in Acts 8 that we're dealing with here, there was this sorcerer named Simon that lived in this town, and he was using sorcery over the people, and the people thought he was a great man of God, and, you know, he made himself out to be someone because he was using this sorcery to deceive the people, and everybody looked up to him as some man that was like a great man of God. Well, Philip comes through town, and he's preaching the gospel, and people start getting saved, and then it says here, even Simon himself, it says in verse 13, then Simon himself believed also. Now, when the Bible says, what must I do to be saved? It says, and they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. According to the Bible, according to all the Scripture that says that what we must do to be saved is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, the narrator of the Bible here says, then Simon himself believed also. Simon gets saved in verse 13 because he believed. Now, this doesn't say, then Simon said that he believed. Simon's words had confessed that he believed, because we don't know Simon's heart. Anybody can say something and not necessarily mean it, but when the Bible says that Simon believed, when the narrator says that, we can trust that the Holy Spirit's not lying, that Simon really did believe. Simon did believe also at the preaching of Philip, and it says, and when he was baptized, so he got saved, he believed, then he gets baptized, and when he was baptized, he continued with Philip, and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. So he's sticking around. He's watching these guys. They're performing these miracles. They're healing people. And he's saying, wow, this is amazing. You know, him and his past of dealing with sorcery and stuff, he never did anything like this because this is the hand of God. This is the Holy Spirit performing these miracles. He didn't have this type of power before. And he was amazed and wondering at the great power of God. So what he sees then, you know, because not everybody had these spiritual gifts until the laying of hands was done by the apostles on other people. Then the Holy Ghost was given unto them so that they can perform these miracles as well. So he sees this happen. He's sticking around with Philip and he sees this happen and he goes and he gets some money together. And he goes up to them and approaches them and tries to get them to give him this power too. So that on whosoever, you know, he lays their hands, he's like, I want to have that power of the Holy Ghost. It says in verse 18, and when Simon saw that through laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. So he's not even asking for the powers of the Holy Ghost as much as he is. He's like, I want to be able to give this gift to other people. He's like, I want to do that too. But he very foolishly approaches them with money as if this is a gift that can be bought and sold. Right? Now, does that just mean he wasn't saved? I mean, the Bible says that he believed. But because he was foolish and a very immature Christian, a baby Christian, doesn't know how things work, he doesn't know the truth on this, he tries to offer him money, does that just automatically mean he wasn't saved? Of course not. So what do? They rebuke him. Right? Verse 20 says, but Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee. He's like, your money is going to die with you. Your money is useless. We don't want your money. He says, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Now, Peter's making a big statement here because the gifts of God can't be bought. And he wants to make that abundantly clear. Now, he's not referring to the gift of salvation, which, hey, the gift of salvation also can't be bought with money. And that's absolutely true. But the gift that he was trying to purchase was not salvation. He was trying to purchase giving the Holy Ghost unto other people to perform miracles. That's the gift. That's the gift that he was trying to purchase. But again, that would make it no longer a gift. If you can buy something, that's not a gift. God's gifts are completely free. And Peter rebukes him for it. He says, look, this is a gift. You can't buy this with money. You can't cheapen the value and the price of this great gift that God has given by trying to offer filthy lucre for it, by trying to offer money for it. So he says in verse 22, repent therefore of this thy wickedness. If you had to turn from your sins or repent from your wickedness to be sins, then why did he already say it says he believed? He believed already, and after he believed, he has to repent of his wickedness. Now, that's true of all of us. Hey, after you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are saved. You have eternal life. That lasts forever. But it's a daily thing that we need to be doing of repenting of our sins, or turning away from our wickedness, our wicked ways, and doing what's right in God's eyes, but has nothing to do with our salvation. This man did not have to turn from his wickedness in order to retain his salvation or to get salvation. He was already saved. But he needed to repent of his wickedness. It says, and pray God if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. But I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. Look, sin will bring you into bondage. Whether you're saved or not, sin will bring you into bondage and you'll be a servant or a slave to your sins. That's why everybody needs to make sure, Christians need to make sure that they're not getting into sin so they don't become a slave to iniquity. They don't become in the bond of iniquity. Now, yes, in the eternal sense, you are free from the law, but if you continue in sin, hey, you're still free from the curse of the law because you're not going to go to hell. But in this lifetime, you will be brought under bondage. Just because you're saved doesn't mean you can no longer be brought under bondage of sin in this lifetime. It's completely possible for people who are saved to get brought under the bondage of alcoholism, to be brought under the bondage of fornication or any other sin that you commit. Then answered Simon in verse 24 and said, pray ye to the Lord for me that none of these things which ye have spoken come upon me. So, here we see, you know, this is another example of usage of the word repent. He says here specifically to repent of his sins, of his wickedness. In the context, that's what the word repent is referring to here. He needs to turn away from that wickedness. But this is not talking for salvation. The salvation was covered in verse 13 when he believed. So let's look at our next example. Look at Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2 is this famous Acts 2:38 is what all the Pentecostals will like to turn to when they tell you what you must do to be saved. Their false gospel. The Pentecostals believe that you could lose your salvation, and many of them believe you must be baptized in order to be saved as well. So what they do is they turn to Acts 2:38, which is the reference we'll be looking at right now. We'll start reading in verse 37. The Bible reads, "Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Now, earlier in the chapter, Peter's rebuking them for saying, you know, hey, Christ came. This is the Christ who you rejected. You killed him. You hung him on a tree. This is what you did. So it pricks them in their heart because they're starting to realize that they were guilty. And they say that, and said unto Peter, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Now that word, what shall we do? Did they ask, what do I have to do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? That's found in Acts chapter 16. No, they said, what shall we do? If someone were to ask me, hey, what should I do? What should I do? Look at their answer. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, well, let's keep reading. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Now here, repent and be baptized. Does that say you have to turn from your sins? No, that just says, it just uses the word repent. So he's implying, you can't get from the context that this is saying you have to turn from your sins to be saved. Because the word repent does not mean turn from your sins. It means what it means in the context of the verse. So when it says that you have to repent, well, they have to change something, right? Well, he follows it up with, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. And see, people who want to take this verse and say, see, you need to be baptized in order to be saved because that is what gives you remission of sins. That word for, in this context, in this sentence, does not mean in order to receive the remission of sins. It doesn't say you need to be baptized in order to receive the remission of sins. The word for means because of. Be baptized, every one of you, because of the remission of sins. Why do they have remission of sins? Because they believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. Because they repented. They used to not believe on Jesus. And this is a perfect example of people who did not believe in Jesus because they had him killed. Because they said, crucify him, crucify him. They needed to repent. They didn't believe on Jesus before. Now he's resurrected from the dead. They better believe on him. What shall we do? Hey, repent. And then get baptized. And he could have said, and then get in church. And then start doing good deeds. And obey the commandments of the law. That's what you should do. Do you have to do all those things in order to be saved? No. That's why Acts 16 says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? When that question is asked, they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. What should you do? Hey, you should repent. You should get baptized. You should do all kinds of things to serve God. And what should they do? Repent. Now, again, in context, when we're looking at all these verses that say repent, where is the context that says sin? I see the remission of sins, but I don't see that that's what you have to repent of. He just uses the word repent. You can't just assume that that's talking about turning from your sins because the word repent is used. Turn to Acts chapter 3, verse number 16. Chapter 3, verse 16 reads, and his name, through faith in his name, hath made this man strong, whom ye see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I wot that through ignorance ye did it, as did also your rulers. But those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all his prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Again, he's saying repent. He doesn't say exactly of what. Repent ye therefore and be converted. Whoa, okay. Well, when he's saying repent and be converted, how is a person converted? That they might hear with their ears and understand with their heart and should be converted and I should heal them. Anyone ever heard that verse before from the Bible? Because that's talking about salvation. That's talking about the conversion of a soul. And how does that happen? Hearing with their ears, understanding with their heart, and believing on the Lord. That's where the conversion takes place. Compare it with other scripture when you want to look at conversion. So when in context here, when it says repent and be converted, well, the repent must mean that they need to change their belief and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Because there's no mention of sins other than the fact that their sins are being blotted out and being wiped away, being pardoned, being washed, being forgiven. Not because they're turning away from them, but because they're covered by the blood of Christ. Look at Acts chapter 5. Acts 5:31. Him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Again, no mention of sins. And you know the reason why, I want to keep you on track here, keep you focused. We're looking at all of the different verses in the New Testament because my claim is that you do not have to turn from your sins in order to be saved. And you can't take a word like repent or repentance and just automatically add sins to that definition of that word. Because you can't prove that. It doesn't always have to do with sins. And we see in the context of these verses, look them up later, there's no context saying that you have to turn from your sins when these verses are read. Look at Acts chapter 11. I know we went through Acts chapter 8 before, but that was the story we covered. Acts chapter 11, as we continue moving forward. When they heard, verse 18, Acts 11, 18, when they heard these things, they held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. Okay, repentance unto life. I assume they're talking about life everlasting, right? This verse is referring to salvation. This verse is referring to a repentance that's required for someone to be saved. Hey, based on the context, this looks like a good verse. So what is this talking about? When this statement is made in context of the story, this is when Peter tells the story of preaching unto the Gentiles. He goes and preaches unto this group of Gentiles, and they start speaking with other tongues. While he's preaching, they are given this gift of the Holy Ghost. Nothing in that story ever mentions them being sorrowful. Nothing in this story ever mentions them, you know, turning away from their sins as Peter preaches the gospel of Jesus Christ to them, how Jesus Christ died, was buried, and rose again 3 days later. But it's obvious that they believed him. They believed him while he was preaching. And they got saved, and then they said, wow, you preach to him, they were able to speak with other tongues, they had the Spirit on them, then God must have granted them also repentance unto life. See, it was kind of more of an astonishment. The Jews in general at that time thought that they were really special and that they were to, because they weren't allowed to marry the heathen, you know, people of other lands and stuff like that, they kind of, I think, got this complex, and you could, when I went through the book of Acts in the study, you see that quite a bit. This notion that because they were this, you know, the seed of Abraham, that they were better than everybody else, and that, you know, the Gentiles were like subclass people. And that's another reason why here the people are kind of astonished, like, wow. Well, then he's also given it to Gentiles. Of course he's given it unto the Gentiles, because anybody who puts their faith in the Lord is saved. Anyone who puts their faith in Jesus Christ is saved, Jew or Gentile, bond or free, male or female. Look at Acts chapter 17. So that was the repentance unto life that they received. They believed. They believed on Christ. Acts chapter 17, look at verse number 30. Acts 17, 30 says, "And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent." Acts 17, this is when the Apostle Paul was at Mars Hill. And he sees all these idols and all these graven images and all these monuments, and they have these plaques and they're written, and there's this one, he says, "To the unknown God." And he starts preaching about that. He's saying, you know what? You've got all these false gods here. And then you have this one that says, "To the unknown God." I'll tell you who the unknown God is, because I know him, because it's the only real God that there is. He's unknown to you, but I'm going to tell you about him right now. And then he preaches and he's saying, look, I'll read this a little bit more in context. Let's look up, let's see, that was verse 30. Start reading in verse 23. "For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you.'" Say, you don't even know who this is. You're ignorant of him. I'll declare him unto you. I'll tell you who he is. Verse 24, "God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temple made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone graven by art in man's device." So he's saying, look, we're the children of God. We shouldn't be thinking that God is like this stone. We're not thinking that God is like this silver or this graven image that man comes up with, this art, right? He's saying that's not God. And then he follows that up in verse 30, "In the times of this ignorance," what ignorance? The ignorance of the people who had no clue who God was, and they were just making up these graven images as if that's their God. That's the ignorance that God winked at. "But now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead." So the repentance that they needed was to stop worshiping their idols. Change their belief. Stop believing in these false idols that can't save and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Very simple. Very simple to see that in Acts chapter 17. No reference to their sin. Oh, you say, but worshiping an idol is a sin. Yeah, it's a sin. But it's not this broad term of repent, you'll turn from your sins, plural, like all of your sins. If you know, you can't just take one word and one thing and say, well, because that's a sin, then you must, and you have to repent of worshiping idols, then because worshiping idols is a sin, then that means you must turn from all of your sins. That's not what the Bible's saying. Look, what you're doing is you're changing your belief. So if part of changing that belief means you stop worshiping idols, which is a sin, then that's part of it. But it doesn't, you can't just apply that and say, well, you just need to repent of all of your sins. It's not what it's saying. You need to change your unbelief or your belief on something else to a belief on Jesus Christ. That is repentance. Look at Acts chapter 20, verse 21. Acts 20, 21, "Testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ." This is basically a restating, a saying, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, again, you see nothing about sin there. Just because you have a comma separation, they say repentance and faith. And I'm not going to get too much into detail about this. You can see this in many, many, many places in the Bible. This doesn't necessarily mean that they're two different things, repentance and faith. Now, sometimes when you put the phrase, a sentence together, they can mean different things. But sometimes it's restating the same exact thing. So don't let that confuse you, that it's saying, oh, well, this says repentance and faith. Well, the repentance is a turning, but it still is involving your faith. So, and nowhere do you see anything about turning from sins. Let's look at Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26, verse 20. But showed first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. Let's get this in a little bit more context here. Let's look at verse number 15. This is Paul recounting his what happened to him on the road to Damascus. In verse number 15, and I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision, but showed first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. For these causes the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. So the vision that he was given by God was, in verse 18, he says, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. It's Jesus Christ speaking to Paul, saying that the faith that's in him, in Jesus Christ, that's what sanctifies them. That's what sets them apart. That's what saves them, is that faith. So that was his instructions to go be a light. And what he did with that, he says, he taught that they should repent and turn to God, put their faith in God, in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he says, and do works meet for repentance. Now, doing works meet for repentance, great. Start showing your faith. That is what we should do. That is something we should teach people to do, is one, get saved, put your faith in Jesus Christ, and two, hey, start doing works. Start doing the works that show that you really do believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Start doing these works that other people can see your faith and that you can be fruitful and do good works for God. Let's turn to our next reference in Romans. Romans chapter 2. Again, the references to sin are lacking. I do not see anywhere in these verses turning from your sins. Nowhere in context. That's why I'm reading a lot of the context to these. The rest of them that I don't read as much, go ahead and look them up for yourself, where I'm covering every verse. Romans chapter 2, look at verse number 4. Well, I'll start reading in verse number 1. Therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. For wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest doest the same things. But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? But after thy hardness and an impenitent heart, treasurest up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds, to them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life, but unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first, and also of the Gentile. And it goes on and on. Verse 4 was the verse that contains the reference to repentance. Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. He's saying, you know, it's God's goodness and God's grace that leads you into this repentance that you need. But again, not very clear on repentance from what, but even more importantly though is the is this talking about our eternal salvation, or is this talking about our you know, things that will come as a result of our sin and not turning from those sins in this lifetime, the trials and troubles that God will bring your way when you disobey him and you're not having respect unto his teachings. But I do not see any clear cut, again, saying you must turn from your sins in order for your soul to be saved. It's not here. Look at Romans chapter 11. Romans 11, 29. Start reading in verse number 27. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. So again, this is not talking about our salvation at all. He's saying that God's gifts and his calling are without repentance. And that's something that God just gives without having to repent, these gifts that he's referring to here in this passage. Not talking about salvation, not talking about turning from sins. And if you're saying, if anything, you can apply this to say, well, see, God's gifts are given without repentance. If you want to cling to this, the topic that repentance is turning from your sins, he's saying, well, God's gifts are given without repentance in this. So if anything, it's going to bolster my claim, but I'm not saying that that's what that means. I'm just saying that this is not showing that you must turn from your sins to be saved, because that's the whole goal when going through all these various references. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 is our next reference. 2 Corinthians chapter number 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, we're going to see a little bit about Paul and what he was thinking after he wrote his first letter to the Corinthians. Verse 8, 2 Corinthians 7 verse 8 says, for though I made you sorry with a letter, I do not repent. Though I did repent, for I perceive that the same epistle hath made you sorry, though it were but for a season. He's saying, look, even though I wrote that first letter to you, and it made you sorry, it made you sad, because I was calling out your sins, I made you sorry with that letter. He's saying, I don't repent. I don't wish I didn't write that letter and change my mind about it. He says, though I did repent. He says, after I wrote it and sent it to you at first, I was kind of thinking, man, maybe I shouldn't have wrote this letter. Maybe I shouldn't have been so hard on him. You know, that was his first thoughts after he sent that letter off. But then he says, you know what? I don't take that stand. He said, I am glad that I sent that letter. He says, for I perceive that the same epistle that made you sorry, though it were but for a season, now I rejoice. Not that you were made sorry. He's like, now I'm really happy. Not because it made you sad. Not because I just want you to be unhappy and to grieve. He says, but that ye sorrowed to repentance. He said, now I'm happy because that sorrow that you got from that letter, the sadness that you experienced when I was railing on your sins and exposing them and showing that you need to change this stuff. He said, I'm glad that you were made sorry after a godly manner, for that ye sorrowed after a godly manner, that ye might receive damage by us in nothing. For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death. So he's saying, you know, for behold, this selfsame thing, verse 11, that ye sorrowed after a godly sort, what carefulness it wrought in you, yea, what clearing of yourselves, yea, what indignation, yea, what fear, yea, what vehement desire, yea, what zeal, yea, what revenge. In all things ye have approved yourselves to be clear in this matter. So he's saying, you know, I didn't want to send it like that at first, but now I'm glad I sent it. I don't repent. I'm not changing my mind that I sent that letter to you. It was actually a very good thing, because when you heard it, you sorrowed, and then you changed your ways, and then you got right with God. and then it made you more zealous and more on fire and more doing the right thing based on the letter that he sent, based on the preaching that he gave them through his letter. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Flip over to chapter 12. It's our next reference to repentance. Second Corinthians chapter 12. Let's look at verse number 20 right near at the end. He says, "For I fear lest when I come I shall not find you such as I would, and that I shall be found unto you such as ye would not. Lest there be debates, envyings, wraths, strives, backbitings, whisperings, swellings, tumults. And lest when I come again, my God will humble me among you, and that I shall bewail many which have sinned already and have not repented of the uncleanness and fornication and lasciviousness which they have committed." So, you know, he's warning them. He's saying, look, I don't want to come back and have to deal with this again. That people haven't repented of these grievous sins, like this fornication and the fornication that he wrote about before that was going on in the church. And he's fearing that they're just going to be living a carnal life and just be a bunch of carnal Christians going around and doing all these, you know, debates, envyings, wraths, strives, backbitings, whisperings, swellings, tumults. Those are all the lusts of the flesh. And he's saying, I don't want to come back to that. So he's hoping that they will repent of this uncleanness and be getting right with God. But again, no reference to salvation. This is talking about turning from their wickedness. This is talking about repenting from sin. But in the context, this isn't talking about them being saved and their souls going to heaven and having everlasting life. It's not there. Although this is a reference to them turning from sin. Like I said, turning from sin is in the Bible. Here it is right here. But it says nothing about receiving everlasting life as a result of turning from sin. Let's go to our next reference. We're getting through this pretty well. We're almost done here with the New Testament. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Let's keep moving forward. Keep plugging through. 2 Timothy chapter number 2. Let's look at verse 21. "If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will." So, okay, here's another reference to repentance. Is this saying that we must turn from our sins in order to receive the knowledge? No. If God will, it's saying as a teacher, as somebody who's an instructor of God's word, he says in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. Those people that have these false doctrines and these false beliefs, they're opposing themselves, they're contradicting God's word. He says in meekness you instruct them because God might give them the repentance that they could change their life and accept the truth, the acknowledging of the truth, that they might receive that repentance. That has nothing to do with turning from sin. We'll give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. The repentance needed is recognizing this is truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. Look, the devil is laying snares for Christians all the time. A snare is a trap. We need to make sure that we recover ourselves out of those traps if we happen to fall into them by getting into sin. A saved person still continues to sin, and we need to watch out for the traps of the devil. So repenting from our sins and not doing sins will help us to stay out of those traps and the snares that the devil lays. But that is not, again, that's not what we need for salvation. Not talking about salvation in this verse anyways. Turn to Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews chapter 6, I've heard multiple interpretations of this chapter. It could be a little bit more difficult to read through. I'm not going to give very much time to my explanation of this chapter and what I believe it's talking about. A lot of people will turn to this and say, see, you could lose your salvation. I don't believe that at all. We have everlasting life. It's eternal life. I believe this chapter is talking about reprobates, people who hear God's word, but they don't really receive it. They don't put their faith on Jesus. They hear it. And then they reject God, and God rejects them, and they're nigh unto cursing. That's my take on this chapter, but I'm going to show you, because this talks about repentance here in verse number 1. The Bible says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. Now, that's really interesting what he's saying, that we need to have repentance from. He doesn't say repentance of sin, repenting from your sin. He says repentance from dead works. Why does he say that? And of faith toward God. Because the vast majority of people that you talk to today are relying on their works to get them to heaven. They're relying on them being a good person. In order to be saved and put your faith completely on Christ, you need to repent from your reliance on your dead works. Because what you think are your good works that's going to get you into heaven, those are dead works. They can't save. They're dead. He says, not laying again that, look, this is basic stuff. This is elementary stuff. We're not going to lay that foundation again. We know that people need to repent of their dead works and have just completely faith in God and not in themselves. That's what Hebrews 6:1 is saying there. He's not saying of repentance from sin and of faith towards God. That would be a different story. He says, no, repentance of dead works. Let's keep reading of the doctrine of baptisms, verse 2, and of laying on of hands, and of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. And this will we do if God permit. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened, and have tasted of the heavenly gift, and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost, and have tasted the good word of God, and the powers of the world to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh, and put him to an open shame. And again, you know, I don't want to get too deep into this verse and into the context of this, but maybe you could show me where this is talking about turning from your sins to be saved eternally, because I don't see it. I don't see it even in this verse. It's talking about people falling away to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. For the earth which drinketh in the rain that cometh oft upon it and bringeth forth herbs, meat for them by whom it is dressed, receiveth blessing from God. But that which beareth thorns and briars is rejected and is nigh unto cursing, whose end is to be burned. And that verse 8 is a real strong reason why I believe that this is talking about reprobates who hear the word of God and don't accept it, because you look up the rejection, being rejected as being reprobate, and bearing thorns and briars is used in other places in 2 Peter 2 and Jude, talking about false prophets who are bearing thorns and briars, that they're not saved. You know, they're of a different seed. They're of the devil, not of God. So they're weeds. They're not the wheat, right? So what is the chaff to the wheat? But that's why I believe this is talking about. I don't want to get too far into that. Let's keep going, because I've got a bunch more verses to get to. We're getting near the end. Hebrews chapter 7. Let's look at verse 21. And I'm just trying to be honest with you. We're going through every single reference. Okay? Decide for yourself. Do you see the turning from your sins in the usage of these repentances? Do you see that this is talking even about our eternal salvation, our souls being saved? Because a lot of these verses, if you think they are, you know, they're not very clear about it. Some of them that are clear, we can see it's obviously talking about the faith. It's talking about the repentance from the dead works, for example, or repentance of from worshiping idols. But not from our sins in general. Hebrews chapter 7, look at verse 21. For those priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath, by him that said unto him, The Lord swear and will not repent, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Here we see very clearly, this is talking about God made a promise, he swore, and he's not going to change his mind. That's what he's saying right here exactly. And he will not repent. Let's go to the next verse. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 17. Nothing about salvation in Hebrews 7, 21. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 17. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. Now, this is referring to back to that story. And again, I'm getting a little bit short on time, so I'm just going to give you a summary. Read the whole chapter, Hebrews chapter 12. It's talking about Esau. And it's talking about Esau not receiving the blessing from Isaac. And what it's saying here is because he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. Esau was weeping unto Isaac, asking him, don't you have a blessing for me, even for me? Because Jacob came in and stole the blessing. So Esau came in, he says, look, I want a blessing too. Can you please give me a blessing? And he was looking for Isaac to repent and to change his mind and to give him a good blessing, but he didn't do it. Because when you go back and you look at the story, Esau didn't get that much of a blessing. And that's what he was begging Isaac for. But he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully. He was going after that, looking for Isaac to change his mind with tears. But he didn't do it. That's Hebrews 12. Let's look at 2 Peter chapter 3. We're almost done. 2 Peter chapter number 3. We'll go into a little bit more detail on this one too. 2 Peter chapter number 3. Real famous verse, but this is talking about in the chapter, we're talking about the day of the Lord coming. We'll read a little bit before verse 9. Verse 9 is the verse that contains the word repentance. Let's look at verse number 4 and saying, where is the promise of his coming? He's talking about people in the last days saying, where is the promise of his coming? The coming of Jesus Christ. Yeah, we heard Jesus Christ is coming back soon. That was over 2,000 years ago. What do you mean he's coming soon? This is what the scoffers say. He says, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. But the heavens and the earth, which are now, by the same word are kept in store. He's saying the same exact word that created everything, the same exact word that caused the flood, the same exact word, he says, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. He's saying, look, don't be ignorant of this. You know, we may think it's a long time since these promises were made. It's been, thousands of years. Right now, it's been over 2,000 years. But he's saying, don't let that trouble you. Don't be ignorant. You need to understand, with God, 1,000 years is like a day. I mean, we go to bed tonight, wake up tomorrow, that's a new day. That's like 1,000 years for God. He's outside of time. It doesn't matter. So when God makes a promise, just because it's been in our minds a long time, 2,000 years, he's saying, you don't need to worry about that. God's not slack concerning his promise. We're going to read that here in verse number 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He's saying, look, it's going to come. Don't worry about it. God made the promise. It's going to happen. But God is long-suffering. He's letting it go and go and go because he wants us to come to repentance. He wants us to change. He wants us to get right. And that's why he's letting it go longer and longer. So he's explaining that he wants it to go. But then he says that why it's been so long. He's explaining that because of God's long suffering. But verse number 10 says, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heaven shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up." And he goes on and on. Now, let's look at that verse about repentance. Verse 9. He says, "Not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." And unless you have a preconceived idea that repentance has to always do with sin, there is no mention in the context here of sin being applicable to this verse. After we've already seen in other contexts that repentance is talking about when it's referring to salvation, and this may or may not be talking about your eternal salvation, but either way you slice it, this isn't talking about us, you know, having to do good works or turning from bad works in order for our souls to be saved. That's not what this is saying, and you cannot prove that from this verse. Let's keep going. We're almost done. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. These are admonitions to the churches that existed back in the days of John. John was delivering these, you know, the Lord gave this revelation unto John. And John was writing these messages in this first few chapters to the churches that existed then. Philadelphia, Sardis, you know, all these various churches that existed. And he's sending them off their different letters. Chapter 2, verse number 5 says, "Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works. Or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent." This is talking to a church. And he's saying, look, get your act together. Start doing those first works that you were doing before, because you kind of let that go by the wayside. Get back into soul winning. Get back into doing your first works. You need to change in the right way and start doing this again. And he says, and if you don't, then I'm going to remove your candlestick. You're no longer even going to be considered a valid church in my eyes. You're not going to be considered a church that I recognize unless you can repent and change that. Verse number 16, Revelation 2, "Repent or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth." Again, I mean, he's talking to the churches. Verse 21, "And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds." Okay, so here's a couple verses. They're talking about repenting from sin, repenting from wickedness, repenting from fornication, repenting from evil deeds. Right? But let's read a little bit more in context here just to see, is this talking about their souls being saved? I mean, it's talking about repenting from their sins. Let's see. I'll go up a little bit. Let's look at verse 18. "And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, These things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach, and to seduce my servants to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, but that which ye have already, hold fast till I come." No reference to their souls being saved from hell. In this chapter, Revelation chapter 2, verses 21 and 22, talking about Jezebel and repenting of her fornication and their adulteries and their wickedness. Now, in order for them to avoid God's judgment and God's punishment on them in this life, they need to repent from their wickedness. They need to do what's right. But this isn't talking about that. This isn't talking about their souls being saved and they have to repent of their fornication to go to heaven. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 3. Remember, therefore, how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. In verse number 19, the Bible reads, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Again, these are talking to churches. On hold. You need to be zealous. You need to repent. You need to make changes. Here's God's critiquing these churches saying, look, you're doing this, this is good, and you're doing this, this is bad. I need you to change what you're doing that's bad and do the good thing. Do the right thing. Repent. Change. Do what's right. Get this sin out of there. These aren't talking about our souls being saved from going to hell. It's not what these verses are talking about. Revelation chapter 9. We're almost done. Revelation chapter 9. Man, there's a lot more I wanted to get to. But it looks like we're only going to be able to finish out the verses that contain the word repent in them in the New Testament. Revelation 9, verse number 20, and the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk, neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. This is talking about when God's wrath is being poured out. And all the different plagues that the people on earth are receiving that took the mark of the beast, they're already damned. These people that took the mark of the beast, they're already damned to hell. The Bible says that everyone that takes the mark of the beast is going to hell. Every single one of them. Anyone who takes the mark of the beast. These people have taken the mark of the beast. This is after God has raptured out his saints, have taken them out. Now he's pouring out his wrath, and he's saying, even though they're still being plagued with all these things, these people aren't even changing their ways, even through all of this. They're not saying, wow, look, God must be punishing us. Let's try to get right by God. Even in their minds, they're not even trying to do that. They're just going to continue to do the same things that they're doing because they're reprobate. They don't get it. And then Revelation chapter 16, same thing, same concept. Revelation 16, verse 9, or in verse 8, and the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and power was given on him to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat, and blasphemed the name of God, which hath power over these plagues. And they repented not to give him glory. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seed of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain, and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds. So again, we see them here not repenting of their wicked deeds, of their wicked actions that they're being judged for, of all of their wickedness that they've done, but not saying that even if they did repent, would they be saved? Not if they took the mark of the beast, they won't. Repent. They can repent of their sins all they want. The Bible says they're not going to. Even though they're facing all this horrible judgment and punishment. But repenting of their sins are going to do good. Look, repenting of your sins did Judas no good. We went over that this morning. Judas repented of the sin of turning in Jesus Christ into the authorities that they could put him to death. Judas did that. And he still went to hell. Why? Because he wasn't saved. Why? Because Jesus Christ said, "Have not I chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil." Turning from your sins, repenting from sins, from fornication, from whatever the sin may be. We've seen some of that in the Bible. But when you see those phrases, it's not associated with receiving eternal life. It's not associated with getting saved. It's going to spare you judgment from God in this lifetime. Absolutely. But it's not going to save you from going to hell. Because why? Because those are your works. And I closed with this morning. I'm going to close with it again this evening. In Jonah chapter 3, the Bible completely defines turning from your wicked ways, turning from your sins as works. Jonah 3:8 says, "But let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn everyone from his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. Who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away from his fierce anger that we perish not? And God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not." God saw their works, that they turned from their evil ways, from their wicked ways. Turn from your evil ways every day. Turn from those wicked ways every day. We ought to do that. But don't trust that because you've done such a good job of turning from your sins, that that's why you're going into heaven. Don't add that and cheapen the gift that God has given you and think that somehow, because of your obedience and because of your good works, that somehow you've contributed somewhat into you getting into heaven, because you haven't. Because it's a free gift that's given by Jesus Christ. Hey, he's the one who lived the perfect life without one spot, without one blemish. He did it all. He sacrificed himself, allowed himself to be crucified on the cross, nailed and hanging there, bearing the sins of the whole world in his own body on the tree. He's the one who bled. He's the one who was buried, and his soul descended into hell for 3 days and three nights before finally rising again from the dead. He did all the work. Don't tell me that I have to add to that and turn from my own sins and give up my sins in order to receive a free gift. Now, if you're grateful for the free gift that God has bought and paid for you, you ought to not want to do any more and add more iniquity unto what Jesus has already done for you, as if you're trampling underfoot the Son of God. But your salvation has already been purchased. It's in God's hand, and it's available for you to receive it by putting your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Faith. Not turning around from your sins. Nobody's turned around from their sins. Everybody still has sins. Don't tell me you've turned from all of your sins. You still have them. You did not do a 180. Not even close. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the clarity in your word. Lord, I pray that you'd give us all the spirit and the wisdom to challenge the doctrines that we hear by looking them up in the Bible for ourselves. Lord, help us to look these things up when we hear stuff, that we would search the scriptures daily whether these things are so. Help us to be like the Bereans, that we don't just blindly accept things that other people say because you assume that, whoa, well, they have a doctorate degree in theology, and they've been studying their Bible, so I'm just going to listen to what they say and believe them and trust them just because they look like they're a lot smarter than me, and they can use some words that sound like they come from the Bible, and I'm not going to worry about doing the act, putting forth the effort and the work of looking into this for myself. God, help us not to have that attitude, but that we would rather challenge everything and look it up for ourselves and see, are these things true? And I think we've demonstrated between this morning and this evening, by looking at all of the references that you have in your holy word about repentance and repenting, that this is not talking about us turning from sins in order to be saved, but rather changing our false belief into one that believes on the Lord Jesus Christ when you refer to salvation. But help us all also, dear Lord, to mortify the deeds of the flesh, to turn from our sins daily, dear Lord, that we would not be brought under the bondage of sin anymore, but that you would help us to have that victory, and that you would Give us a heart to repent, dear Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.